So what is the answer which you have to write for interaction? Symbolic interactionism. In the introduction, you have to write why symbolic interactionism came. Why symbolic interactionism came? Sociology, according to non-positivism, is not a science. They rejected the role of sociology as a science. Because science studies only objects, sociology studies subjects. Since the subject matter differs, the methodology also should differ, the principles also should differ. So the laws of science have to have no place in sociology. Herbert Blumer, formally propounded the school of symbolic interactionism. He says, individuals are not passively guided by biological stimulus or sociological stimulus. They respond to the stimulus according to their perception. They don't mechanically react, but they act. Individuals, they lend meaning to the symbols based on the circumstances. So meanings of symbols are not fixed entities. Meanings of symbols varies according to the individual imagination. And during interaction, symbols are created, meanings are created. During interaction, there is a need for interpretation. So sociology is not an objective study of reality. Sociology involves a subjective study of reality. Sociology studies fact, not fact, which is subject independent. Sociology studies value, which is subject dependent. Mind dependent, it is not mind independent. So study of objective reality and subjective reality are polar opposites. Hence requires interpretation and imagination, not methods of science or the principles of science. Right? You can also give some inputs about G.H. Mead as a symbolic interactionist, if time permits. So, Durkheim wanted to give a methodology to sociology, for which he was writing a book, Rules of Sociological Method, suggesting the rules to be followed to study social fact objectively. And the first rule is, treat social facts as things. He applied this rule in the study of suicide. He studied suicide as a fact. He collected data on suicide. He studied suicide as a fact, as a thing, which is external to the individual, which is independent of the individual, which is constraining the individual, which is generally diffused. So suicide is not individual dependent, suicide is dependent by the suicidogenic current generated by the society. Suicide is generally present, it is not class dependent, that the upper class alone will commit suicide, the lower class alone will commit suicide. It is not class dependent, it is not race dependent, it is not geography dependent. It is independent of individuals, it is independent of geography or biology. It is generally diffused everywhere and it controls the individual because every individual living in the society will be exposed to this suicidogenic current. So he treats suicide as a thing. By treating social fact as a fact, he wanted to bring objectivity in the social science research. He wanted to impose neutrality in the mind of the researchers because the challenge is a subject studying a subject. Hence, there is a possibility of the subject being influenced by his own priorities. So he wanted to inject the tendency of objectivity into the mind of the researcher, which is why he says the first rule for a social science researcher is treat social facts as things. So statistical data should be used. Correlation and causation should be established. The individual should be detached from his cultural influence by studying social fact, as a thing. Durkheim was ambitious to make sociology a subject which is having a status that of the natural science. Natural science was glorified for the reason of prediction, the possibility of prediction, the predictive role of natural science, the precision present in natural science, the objective study possible in natural science was tempting Emile Durkheim to take up these approaches of science and inject into social science. On one hand, by doing so, he has created sociology as an independent discipline, but at the same time, he was rejected subsequently in 20th century by non-positivists. Weber questioned the role of observation in social science research forwarded by Emile Durkheim when he said treat social facts as things. Durkheim says when you treat social facts as things, you are observing. Observation is impersonal observation. Observation should not involve interpretation. Observation should be supported by empirical data. It should be unbiased. The possibility of observation without any subjectivity of social fact was questioned by Max Weber. Observation can be used only when the fact is mechanical fact, when the fact is physical fact. But when you study social fact, you cannot treat social fact as things. Because social facts are no things. Durkheim himself knows that social facts are no things, which is why he says social facts should be treated as things. He is not telling social facts are things. Max Weber criticizes Emile Durkheim, saying that social reality should be studied using not observation but interpretation. He rejected sociology as a science. He wanted sociology to be called as interpretative science, not as a natural science. What is fact? Who gives importance to fact? What is value? Who gives importance to values? And how far the gap between fact and value can be bridged? This is how you have to think. A straightforward question means, who spoke about fact? Who spoke about value? And is there any, you know, similarity or differences? Is there any complementarity or contradiction between these two concepts? And how would you conclude this? So start with positivism. Positivism emphasizes on study of fact. Best example, Emile Durkheim gives importance to social fact. He says treat social facts as things. Fact refers to those aspects which are independent of the observer, those aspects of reality which is independent of the observer. So there is only one fact called as visible fact according to positivists, especially Comtean positivism. But Emile Durkheim acknowledges the fact of invisible fact called as social fact. But he says invisible fact can be studied like that of a visible fact. Social fact can be studied as things, which means invisible fact is social fact, which can be studied as a visible fact using scientific methods of observation and comparison. Emile Durkheim was criticized by Max Weber. Social facts are not pebbles in the beach which can be counted. Social fact is involving values. Now what is value? The role of value in social science was highlighted by idealists. Immanuel Kant talks about how science studies facts, social science studies value. There is a logical gulf between fact and value. Max Weber comes and says there can be a bridge between these two through interpretation. So my Weberian method will help to bridge the gap between fact and value. The challenge in sociology is whether sociology should go in the way of fact or they should go in the way of value. Positivism wanted sociology to go in the way of fact. Studying value will depart sociology from its goal to produce scientific theories about society. But non-positivists wanted sociology should not be a science at all, and sociology is having a different aim, studying the invisible reality which requires the role of mind of the researcher. Max Weber says values guide human behavior. In his Protestant Ethics, he says how Protestant Ethics, which is a value, guides the human action. Action for Weber includes meanings, meanings and motives given by mind. So divorcing study of mind from study of society will be a sociological mistake. And studying value objectively is a challenge posed before any social science researcher. Gunnar Myrdal makes this statement that total objectivity is an illusion in social science research. The possibility of objectivity in social science research is a matter of debate central to sociological discourses. Those who position their sociological stand as objectivity is absolutely possible, they are called as positivists. And non-positivists reject the possibility of objectivity in sociology. Now what is objectivity? According to Robert Bierstadt, D-I-E-R-S-T-E-D-T-T. S-T-E-D-T. D-I-E-R-S-T-E-D-T. Robert Bierstadt. Says objectivity refers to a frame of mind which is not influenced by race, culture and personal prejudices. A frame of mind that the researcher's mind shall not be influencing the researcher's value, should not influence the research. The personal prejudices of the researcher shall not contaminate the outcome of the research. Explain how positivism says objectivity is highly possible. Write about Auguste Comte, write about Emile Durkheim. I have discussed so many things on Emile Durkheim in the before concepts or questions. Non-positivism, you write how objectivity cannot be guaranteed because, well, science studies facts, it is nothing but subject studying object, it can be objective. When subject studies subject, it cannot be objective. So objectivity is not possible absolutely according to non-positivism. Why they say? Use symbolic interactionism, use phenomenology, use Max Weber. And write how Max Weber says through certain guidelines I can ensure that you are trying for objectivity, striving hard for objectivity. Even though you cannot guarantee objectivity, you have to desire. Objectivity is a desirability but cannot be guaranteed. By being value neutral, you can strive towards objectivity even though you cannot guarantee objectivity. The choice of the research, the choice of the topic of research will be guided by the personal likes and dislikes. So the topic selection will be guided by values. But subsequently, after the topic is chosen, he should be striving towards subjectivity. Using multiple methodology, using Verstegen, using trained researchers, bridging the gulf between the subject and the observed and the observer, the researcher and the researched. But Gundar Mittal says classification of countries into first world, second world, third world, they are not objective classification, they are subjective classifications. Andhra Bhatte says how in his village study of Sripuram village he found that the field setting will not allow objectivity. Judgmental system studied by Oscar Lewis conclusion is it is exploitative. By William Weiser conclusion is it is solidarity. So field constraints are there, ideological preference, ideological contradictions are there, hence conclusions may differ and objectivity is a question in social science research. But Alvin Goldner says sociologists are not mute spectators, sociologists are social workers. There are certain values which has to be propagated, there are certain values which has to be criticized. So sociologists need not be value neutral, they have to have values. If still you perceive the value neutrality for sociologists, then you are only boarding a ship which is sinking, according to Alvin Goldner. So you can start with Adam Smith in 1976, writes about Wealth of Nation, where he says the material advancement is a consequence of all the material advancements are the outcomes of division of labor. Economic division of labor was hailed by economists, classical economists. Even Cambridge School economists, when they advocated the comparative advantage theory, they they looked at economic division from the economic point of view. They said division of labor is an economic fact. But Durkheim says division of labor is not an economic fact. It is not having ramification only to the economic system of the society. It has ramification in all the spheres of the society. It has the support of non-economic institutions as well. So economic division of labor should be replaced by social division of labor. Economic division of labor hence is not an economic fact. Division of labor is only a social fact. How division of labor is a social fact? He is classifying society into two types. A simple society characterized by mechanical solidarity and a complex society characterized by organic solidarity. Explain what is mechanical solidarity. Explain what is organic solidarity. A solidarity of resemblance is mechanical solidarity. Unity is not because unity is because of uniformity, mechanical solidarity. Unity is because of interdependence, organic solidarity. So division of labor is what the order of the time. He speaks about the need for structural differentiation in the form of specialization. Division of labor is a consequence of progress. It is an indication of specialization. So society is moving from simple to modern through specialization, through occupational division of labor. But this is not just leading to economic progress, it is also leading to social unity. But this social unity was threatened because of the pathological division of labor. Write about pathological division of labor. However, critics are pointing out how it is leading to boredom. Herbert Marcuse, in his One-Dimensional Man, speaks about specialization is robbing of the creativity. Emile Durkheim says capitalism through division of labor not resulting in solidarity, but division. Division of labor is not division of work, it is only division of workers. It is division of laborers, not division of labor. It is not solidarity, it is exploitation. It is not unity, it is only alienation. At the cost of formalistic, at the cost of substantive rationality, only formalistic rationality is advanced by division of labor, says Max Weber. However, he is looking at the problems of French society. He wanted to give solution to the problems. He wanted to forge unity amongst people by advocating a concept called as organic solidarity, for which he is called as an ultra-nationalist in French society. Sociology and psychology, simply you start with what is sociology defined. Sociology means study of society. Psychology means study of soul. Logo means study. Psy means soul. Study of soul is psychology. Study of whole is sociology. S-O-U-L, soul. W-H-O-L-E, whole. Whole is the society collective. Soul is the mind of the individual. Speak about the differences. Sociology wants to make a positivistic study of the group mind, whereas psychology wanted to make a scientific study of individual mind. So sociologists give importance to social processes. social institutions, value system, and the norms of the society. Whereas psychologists give importance to cognition, interpretation, problem solving, personality, and attitude formation. Sociology and psychology are inextricably related to each other, because psychologists cannot draw any inference, they cannot get any input about the study of mind by discarding the role of social institutions or social processes. So the conclusion derived by psychologists ignoring sociology or society will be unintelligible, will be incomplete. Similarly, sociologists ignoring the role of individual mind cannot draw conclusion which is comprehensive. So sociology and psychology, they have collaborated with each other, and that what resulted in the emergence of a new discipline called as social psychology. John Bowlby, a social psychologist, in a study of juvenile delinquency, found how juvenile delinquency is because of maternal deprivation. So crime is because of the lack of socialization. R.K. Merton, in a study of Anomian social structure, finds how deviance is a product of not the individual mind. Deviant is not a person with pathological personality, but deviant is a social creation. He is a product of the social structure. G.H. Mead gives importance to the role of mind in the making of society. Mind controls the self, and the action of self constitutes society. Mind is reflexive, hence self is dynamic, and that results in social change, according to G.H. Mead. Immanuel Durkheim spoke about the role of collective conscience in the construction of the society. He says collective conscience is internalized by the society, members of the society, and this is no different from Sigmund Freud's concept of superego. When Durkheim says it is socialization of personality, Freud says internalization of the personality. So superego of Freud is having so much of resemblance with the collective conscience of Immanuel Durkheim. Non-positivism draws heavily from psychological perspectives to construct their sociological theories. Symbolic interactionism of Herbert Bloomer speaks about how mind is lending meaning to the symbol. Even Max Weber, in the social action theory, speaks about how meanings and motives are mind dependent. Of course, influenced by culture. We are not passive being. We are not passive entities influenced by culture. We actively interpret culture according to our individual experience, says Max Weber. Phenomenology speaks about how there is a construction of reality based on the perception and assumption of the human mind. Ethnomethodology also speaks about the role of documentary method to emphasize how mind is constructing reality, and hence order is only an assumption, a social fiction. So, in conclusion, given the complementarity of the two disciplines, we find how both make study of reality complete. Reality can be understood comprehensively with the use of principles and methodology advocated by both sociology and psychology, which makes study of modern society enriched with multiple perspectives. And this paves way for growth of sociology as a matured discipline in 21st century. So religion is nothing but society is what we are telling in this question. In the introduction, you have to write about why he studies religion. Religion study was attempted by Emile Durkheim to give a functional explanation of religion, which will be strikingly different from the theological explanation of religion or philosophical explanation of religion. He wanted to study religion in its pure form, hence chose Arunta tribe and totemism as the most ancient religion. Criticizing E.B. Taylor, he says totemism is the first religion, not animism. Criticizing Max Muller, he says religion is not because of fear, religion is real. Religion is permanent, religion is transcendental. The role of religion lies in classification of the world into sacred and profane. Sacred is nothing but the symbol of the society. Sacred is the projection of the society. And sacred is nothing but society divinized. Worshipping sacred is worshipping the society, because it is society which gave you an identity, society which gave you a solidarity, society gave you social control, society gave you a kinship obligation. So man without society will be a nullity. The life of man without society will be like the life of a fish without water, or a baby without mother. Since man is utterly dependent on the society, he started indirectly worshipping society by inventing religion. So religion is nothing but collective worship of the powers of the society. However, religion is not social worship. Religion is not God. Society is not God, according to critics. R.K. Merton sees the disintegrative role of religion as a reason for communalism and fundamentalism. Malinowski speaks about how religion is not just for individual, religion offers functions for religion. Religion is not just for the society, religion is functional for individual. Marxist looks at religion as the opium of the masses, which is only to exploit the people. So using religion, the owners of private property exploit the non-owners. Religion is an obstacle for social change, according to Marxism. However, Durkheim was pained by the social turmoil which was experienced by France of 19th century. People became selfish. They disrespected the powers of the society, and that what resulted in increasing corruption. He wanted to tell people to worship society so that the problems of French society can be remedied and society of France will be now peaceful, harmonious and prosperous. Nothing but critically, I am speaking about positivism, write about positivism. Critically analyze positivism means write positivism, criticize positivism with anti-positivism or non-positivism. So what is positivism? Positivism is a school of philosophy which wanted to make sociology as a scientific study of society. It was positivism which was sowing the seeds of sociology in 19th century. Positivism wanted to use scientific method for the simple reason that science can predict reality absolutely. So sociological theory also will have to predict reality. Will have to formulate theories which can help in understanding and predicting the society better with precision. Write about Auguste Comte as a positivist. Write about law of three stages. Write about Emile Durkheim as a positivist. When you write about Emile Durkheim as a positivist, you have to write about Durkheim on suicide. The best study to illustrate Durkheimian positivism was study of suicide. Then you challenge these two views. Bring who? Idealism against positivism. First you bring social action perspective of Max Weber. Then you bring symbolic interactionism. Then you bring phenomenology, ethno-methodology. And finally you tell, according to non-positivism, using scientific theories to construct sociological laws is not contributing for any intellectual growth in sociology, rather it is only giving rise to sociology becoming a dependent brother of natural science. It cannot become an independent discipline. So use of science in sociology is not causing any intellectual revolution in sociology. But at the same time, it was positivism which gave an identity to sociology in 19th century. The father of sociology was positivism. It was instrumental to give a subject matter, a methodology to sociology, so that 20th century sociology became critical to positivism and 21st century sociology became humanistic sociology, inviting multiple perspectives to understand social reality, making sociology a comprehensive study of society, giving enriched knowledge about the social institutions and social actors. So despite of all these criticisms against positivism, positivism should be celebrated for the intellectual contribution it gave to the rise of a new discipline called sociology. Without positivism, there will not be any sociology. The growth of sociology may be criticism against positivism, maybe because of criticism against positivism, but primarily it was positivism which sowed the seed of sociology, for which sociology today is becoming an enriched discipline which is having so much of relevance, which is having acceptance to study not just individuals but also groups, not just individuals but also institutions. So the relevance of sociology today has expanded its horizon. Sociology today is used to study interpersonal relationship to international relation thanks to positivism. Industrial society, I have told you, industrial revolution was not just an economic revolution, it was a social revolution for the following reasons. What were the changes which was imposed by industrial revolution to the society? Change in family. How to explain change in family? Nuclear family. Individualism. Right? Gender equality. Because both will have to work today in industrial society, so there is possibility of gender equality. How the social structure is changing? Is there any hierarchical feudal order present today? No. Because free market economy freely distributes service irrespective of your birth. It gives importance to individual accomplishment and merit. It gives new opportunity for people who are backward by the social structure, caused by the social structure. So structurally backward people now can become economically forward thanks to industrial revolution. And new art, new food habits, urbanization, transportation, formal association, bureaucracy, democracy, cosmopolitan culture, religious education getting replaced by secular education, secularism, that religion is becoming privatized, religion has no place in public place, religion is fair, and there is no monarchy, the monarchy will tumble down, democracy will replace the dictatorship. It will create a cult of equality, liberty and social justice. Nationalism, not communal identity. A national identity will be forged. Respect for nature in the coming times. So there will be more and more social movements for constructive issues like saving the earth, saving the planet earth, rule of law. So all these institutions were the products of industrial revolution. So industrial revolution did not contribute only for economic prosperity or new factory mode of production and market economy. It cannot be called purely as an economic revolution, it has to be called a social revolution for this reason. The changes introduced by industrial revolution was seen by two diametrically opposite perspectives, one forwarded by economists like classical economists of classical economists like Adam Smith, how they supported free market economy. And the other who opposed radicals, especially Karl Marx. So, sociology is nothing but a study of society which was a product of debate, discourses, contestations, oppositions and formulation of new theses. Sociology has become a dynamics because of the dialectics present in the thinking of different schools of sociologists, for which sociology today is a multidisciplinary discipline. Right? So this is what you have to write in the conclusion. Using this as a model, write the answer.